I have Sam Kelly with me. Sam is a pastor's kid, like I am. His father pastors a great church, very large church in Virginia Beach, Wave Church. And my father pastors Second Baptist Houston, which, would it qualify as a mega church? Anyway, so I grew up in that. Yes. And Sam and I are just going to talk a couple of PKs about where we are as a culture. And, you know, Sam is the guy, too. I'll say this. Sam is just cool. We have also a subculture that chases cool.
I got a
cool.
couple years left, I think.
Yeah, but...
maybe not. Maybe not know, even a couple.
We have a number of leaders out there. God bless them.
Yep.
They
those pastors.
They chase cool.
We do. Just be
you. And you can tell a lot of them were complete nerds in school. And God's called them and anointed them. And yes. Now they have a little bit of limelight and they think,
yeah.
It's kind of the Jeff Bezos principle. Jeff Bezos, that guy is hilarious.
He is.
He is a walking, talking nerd, little goober. And now he's trying to dress in Gucci, Off-White, and whatever the other, you know, Goyard. And I'm like, that's not him.
No. No, it's not. Just be you. If you're a nerd, be a nerd.
Yes. So I think a lot of pastors, it's like they're reliving those glory days.
Those high school years that they didn't get.
Like, man, I got to get the tats. I've got to, here, you know, you got to lift weights. It's just funny.
Yeah.
It's funny to me.
It's pretty great.
And I understand it because I've chased cool before. Some of the stupid things I've worn. Oh, my gosh, embarrassing. Anyway, we've had this whole, you know, cottage industry now because of this, led by people, I don't know, Tim Ross. I don't know, Tim. I've seen some of his stuff. And basically, people like him, I'll use him as an example. They are spiritual teenagers, but don't know it. There's seasons in the spiritual life. There's infancy, there's childhood, and you could argue that there are those tumultuous teenage years. A guy like him is paused on puberty. When you are a pubescent, you tend to have this kind of rebellious thing. You have this thing like, well, I know the score, I know the deal. I understand what life's all about. But as you move through maturity, the book of Hebrews says, go on to maturity. You look back and go, oh, man, I was an idiot. I didn't know what in the world I was talking about. I thought I did. I thought I knew what marriage was about. I thought I knew what parenting was about. I thought I knew what authority was about. I thought I knew. I thought I knew. I thought I knew.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think one of the things that's taking place that I think is really good is in regards to how polarizing the culture is, is it's making pastors and churches have to take a stand. And unfortunately, we're seeing a lot of people that aren't. But the ones who are, I believe, are going to continue to see God do tremendous things. That's why I'm so thankful for our church, is we have unapologetically stood on the timeless truth of God's word, which who would have thought that would be controversial?
I know, it's really interesting. You know, my father back in the day, kind of a history lesson, in the 80s, he and Charles Stanley stood side by side and literally fought for the authority of Scripture.
Wow.
And it really has broken my heart to see where Andy has gone, Andy Stanley recently, and others that have really surprised me. But I just wonder, man, what would his dad think about the stances that he's taken? I don't know.
Well, it's just the pendulum swinging it's just a complete overreaction, swinging the exact opposite way. And, you know, I heard someone say a lot of young preachers are trying to give Jesus a PR job and make Jesus and the gospel more presentable to more people.
Trying to give him a facelift.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's like, no, like the gospel is the gospel.
That's right.
He doesn't need a PR job. He doesn't need a facelift. He needs to be presented in the way he is. And the most loving thing that we can do to broken people is to present the gospel as is, which is repentance, turn from your sin, and find true sources of hope, find the real purpose of your life in Jesus. And is that always comfortable and easy?
though.
Absolutely not. Right. Is it worth it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. What would you say to Sam about, I know you have, we've always had people to throw grenades at the church ever since the church has been the church.
Yeah.
And recently, because of this, you know, all of our digital world, now people that didn't really have voices, I mean, now and then they would write you letters and things like that back in the day. Now, all of a sudden, people that didn't have voices have these voices, and negativity really, really sells. Can make people rich.
Yeah.
And even negativity toward the church. But I saw recently someone showed me this excerpt from Tim Ross and I think Mike Todd or whatever. But Tim Ross was talking about the fragility of the church, how the church doesn't accept broken people, how they'll say we're a place of grace, but then someone shows up and they're too messed up. And I'm thinking to myself, that is absolutely crazy.
Church is telling the whole world, come as you are. But when they show up as they are, they're too fragile to even handle it. This is a place where the broken can feel at home. Then the broken come and we're like, oh my God, you're broken. They're repulsed by it. I didn't know you were that broken. Either we can deal with a mess or we can't. Which one is it? Right? And then you're mad that we've created environment to like try to navigate through a mess. Right. So yeah, church fragility is a real thing.
Yeah, and it's just not true. And it's just funny. It's a lot easier to criticize than it is to build. And I just, there's a lot of people that are saying we want to help the capital C church by giving critique. And I just ask, like, what are you doing in your local church? So Tim Ross, what are you doing to help build the local church and not just build a platform?
How about a guy like Tim Ross? What does he talk about how to share the Lord with someone?
Yeah.
We stop trying to preach to people that have never said that they want to follow Jesus. Calling someone born into the state of sin a sinner is the biggest no-duh, Captain Obvious statement that you can ever make. You're a sinner. Of course I was. I was born in sin. What else do you expect me to do? But as I always say, are you being that loud against all the heterosexual sex that's happening in your church? Yeah. When your convocation is basically just a covert freakneek, let's not act like all them white dresses are staying down. Some of y'all bishops is knocking down the secretary, and your wife got on a big old church hat, not because it's fashionable. She's trying to cover her face because she can't even say amen to your service.
Why does he talk about someone on his podcast that he's personally led to Christ?
Yep.
Why doesn't he show what he's doing within the context of his local church? Why doesn't he talk about the fact that most pastors and staff members and church people are amazing? Are there some who aren't?
Yeah.
Yes. Is there some chicanery and shadiness in some churches? Yes.
Yeah.
We're not perfect. But I'm telling you, by and large, Sam, and I know you've traveled the world with your dad, and I've had the opportunity to do so as well, the best people I know, the best Christians I know are people
absolutely
planted in the church.
And that's what's so unfortunate. In fact, I just had a conversation with our youth staff and just talking about be careful of the content that you're consuming. Number one, if you're a part of a local church, the primary diet that you should be fed off of is your senior leader, your pastor. And in today's content craze world, it's really easy to get pieces of here and pieces of this and pieces of that. And what you don't realize is it starts to create tensions between the vision of what God has called you to be a part of and the vision that you've been called to support. And you start going, man, the grass is green over there. And here's what's unfortunate is these guys have this really big platform. And what they don't realize is so often they are actually hurting the church.
That's right.
They're saying, hey, your senior pastor is putting a tamp on your creativity, and you'd be better off if you stepped up and did your own thing, and God's going to use you.
Or
in
they'll say staff members are manipulated and led by fear.
Yeah,
I'm like, I face fear every day. Guilty.
Totally.
I face the fear of God, and just the fear of the pressure and things I put on myself. So fear's not bad.
Yeah.
I think we use that. Some of these people use that to get away from work.
Absolutely. And 99.99% of the issues come down to authority issues. These are people who do not want to submit to godly, biblical authority. And rather than submitting to that, they take an ego trip and say, I'm out. The moment I get challenged and someone calls me out for something, I'm out.
Exactly.
And that is, I think about the verse that says, spare the rod, spoil the child. And we've got a lot of old, spoiled children. Again, it's like you said, is the church perfect? Absolutely not. But I would so much rather spend my time building and being a part of and growing God's kingdom than starting my own podcast and lobbing all my criticisms at it and actually end up dividing it. Yeah. Like I've got way too much, I've way too much fear of the Lord.
I do too.
To do that.
And speaking of pastors, probably the best pastors I know are the ones that we'll never even know about.
Yep.
They're out in smaller areas and in smaller contexts, but they are. I just want to do a big shout out of positivity and love to all of the Bible teaching, Bible preaching pastors.
Absolutely.
Because it's I've been saying this over and over, but it's like what Troy Aikman told me. I know it's a name drop, but he's a friend of mine. He told me, he said, of all the criticism that people have leveled toward him as a player back when the Cowboys were Cowboys, you know, he said, whenever someone would tell me something, I would think, I've thought about that 1,000 times. So the thing is, whatever you say about the church, whenever you try to rip apart a leader or a pastor who has released someone or who says no.
Yep.
And you say, oh, man, he's squelching my creativity. No, because he's thought about it 1,000 more times than you've even thought about it. So it's easy for me to criticize the NBA, but I've never played in the NBA.
Totally.
And you have to ask yourself the question about these guys. Yeah, they might go in and out of churches, or maybe they pastored for a year or two and God called them somewhere else or moved them somewhere else. You got to ask yourself, are they in the game?
Yeah.
And I ask myself that all the time when I'm talking to leaders. I don't mind consultants. I don't mind reading books about leadership, but if someone's not in the game,
doing it,
you don't even listen.
Yeah, because it's not too hard to come in and say what people are doing wrong and what they can do better.
Oh no,
it's a completely different thing to actually do it.
I mean, I could come up with a big list of what I'm doing wrong right now. So it's just but I just don't want people like this to sow seeds of discord without being called out. Because they're bold, they rip the church and us up.
Yep.
So I'm gonna stand to go, no, this is wrong.
Absolutely.
I'm just gonna be silent on this issue. But it's a sad day.
It is
when it's a sad day when you're making a living off of this. And I think Tim was talking about pastors writing books and the different churches buying the books.
One of the type of pastors that pisses me off is the pastor has basically turned their whole church into their book club. They got a few thousand members. They write a book. Everybody in the church buys the book. It ain't even a bestseller. You got a captive audience, right? And so you go on the road and you sell some more books and blah, 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 blah. And then you say, God bless me with this. I'm walking in the blessings of the Lord. You're walking in the blessing of tithes and offering and a few thousand books that you sold to your own people.
Yeah.
But let's not act like you started 9 Smoothie Kings. You know what I mean? And you got some other income on the side. And therefore, no, you're church rich. You're church rich.
Yeah. Man, that guy's getting rich off of church people.
Yep.
I mean, church people listen to him, watch him.
Yeah, it's hypocritical. He's doing the exact same thing.
Exactly.
Just to a different audience.
Yeah.
But that are from different churches.
Exactly. Exactly.
Ooh.
So, was my father perfect? Is he a perfect leader? No. Am I perfect? No. Are you perfect? No. But give me a break. It comes back to honor and authority issues. And you always have to give this caveat. Have people taken advantage of that? Yes.
Yes.
But I'm talking about 95%.
Yep.
And the churches, we're the entity, Sam, that's welcomed the LGBTQ. We've welcomed
absolutely
the sex workers. We've welcomed the broken. We've welcomed the addict.
Yep.
And these guys, I mean, the heresy of, what's this guy's name again?
Tim Ross.
Tim Ross, I saw it. The heresy of Tim Ross saying that a girl comes up, maybe she's a prostitute, and they talk about the church being a place of grace, and the pastor is thinking about getting in bed with her first as opposed to helping her.
How about if a girl that's been an escort for 18 months decides she doesn't want to do this anymore, comes into the church, how about you make sure it's safe enough for her to tell you what she was for the last 18 months without you trying to sleep with her, male or female?
What? That is so pathetic. I mean,
it's crazy. It's crazy.
What are they doing? I mean, this is insanity.
It is. It is.
If you're not talking about repentance, faith, if you're not talking about being planted in the church, if you're not talking about sharing Jesus with others, why do we have time for that? And Tim, like so many of these guys, it's just so easy to see, you got authority issues, my man. God's a God of authority. God's a God of honor. And I know sometimes authority can be misused. I know sometimes honor can be abused. I understand that. But I'm talking about biblical honor, and you have a problem with it. And sadly, people that I've seen with authority issues, because it's grounded and founded in pride, they have a hard time ever understanding they have those issues. And they have a hard time understanding confession and repentance. But see, what Tim needs to be preaching is, you need to find a church and get under the authority that God has granted the church.
And we see it in our culture across the world. Obviously, you know, I'm a youth pastor, and there's just a lot of generational struggles with authority. It is a big issue, and it's really disappointing to see people whose students are looking up to in the Christian faith doing the exact same thing and sowing seeds of dishonor everywhere and making people second guess the authority of the local church. Mm-hmm.
This is one of the things that really attracted me as a young pastor, Sam, to churches that in movements that understood those issues. I know I come from a place that taught that, and the success, the blessings of God speak for themselves at Second Baptist Houston, which is, I mean, the largest church you've never heard of. It's one of the largest churches in America. And Dad's been there for, I don't know, a year.
Yeah.
But I remember early on, just being around Andy Stanley. He's a very talented guy, but sadly he's a deconstructionist. He's a provocateur. And I remember 20-something years ago telling Lisa, man, Lisa, Andy's got authority issues.
Yeah.
He does. And so I just thought about it, and more I've seen it come out. So these deconstructionists, they have authority issues. They have daddy issues, a lot of them.
Yep.
The pendulum has swung too far the other way. They're hurt, and they want to hurt others. And I get it. The church world, being a pastor's kid, you know, a big church is tough.
Yep. But let's talk about the amazing sides of the local church. My life, I wouldn't have the family I have. I wouldn't have the marriage I have. I wouldn't be the leader I am if it was not for the local church. I am a byproduct of being a part of and engaged in the local church. And I know you are as well. And I I love people who understand the power of the local church and realizing that the church is the hope of the world.
Yes,
the local church is what's going to continue to push the gospel down the field.
Question.
And that's what I want to be a part of.
I do too.
It's what I want to build.
And we just, within building the church, pushing the ball downfield, we have to understand that we constantly are seeing UFOs.
Yeah.
Unidentified freeloading observers.
That's true.
And Sam, isn't it funny now, because our church is known as a worshiping church. It's funny how we have turned kind of this worship movement into its independent
We worship theme. Worship.
We worship worship.
Yeah. It's unfortunate. I remember growing up and seeing things like Hillsong United, and growing up and seeing, how cool is it that a church is building and creating songs that are cutting edge and making a difference.
And Sam, that was one of the things I've told you that attracted me to Hillsong and Brian Houston, the absolute genius leadership of providing a platform for creativity.
Yes. And within
worship.
The local within church.
The local church. And what's so hilarious is I heard Tim Ross say how people stifle creativity in the church and pastors or whatever. I have seen Brian.
Yeah.
And heard Brian talk to back in the day.
Yep.
When it was like popping, I have seen him and heard him say, "We're not doing this.
Yep.
We're changing that. This is Hillsong."
Yeah.
So all this crap you hear from these people saying, "Oh, the church stifles my creativity and the church has declawed the lion." Please.
Yep.
Play it. But I love that.
Yeah.
About Hillsong.
Totally. And here's what happens as a creative when you submit to the local church. Number one, it's not all about you. That's healthy.
Let me stop. Whoa. Now that right there, Sam. Say that again.
When you submit yourself to a local church as a creative, you realize, number one, it's not all about you. That's really, really healthy. Number two, you don't get all the applause. And number three, you realize that you're a part of something bigger than yourself.
Yes.
And that is always only healthy, because newsflash, it's not about us. It's about building the kingdom of God, not our own kingdom.
Isn't
and we've
true?
Got a lot of people that are pretty set on building their own kingdom and saying that it's for the kingdom of God.
That's great. Yeah. That's really great.
It's like even the thing we heard, I think it was Tim Ross say about how pastors are controlling. And it's like, I think about the picture of a shepherd with his sheep. You would say that a shepherd is controlling over the sheep that he's responsible for. Why? Because he cares about the sheep.
Yes.
So yes, of course, a pastor.
And in controlling, that has got to be one of the most naive, idiotic statements I've heard. Hey, Tim, leadership is about control.
Yeah.
But listen to me very carefully. We have a large church.
Yep.
I do not control Fellowship Church. I can't. I control certain things in my life and control certain entities. I lost control, Sam, when we hit over 200 people.
Yeah.
Totally. So to sit there and say that again, Tim, he's just advertising his ignorance. He's paused on puberty. Guys, you have to understand it. And Tim, you need to move through this.
Yeah.
But he's not going to.
No.
And
let's even talk about this. Like, as the youth pastor of Fellowship Church, my responsibility and my role is not to build my own church within a church. Mm-hmm. It's to build the vision of Fellowship Church and create an environment that is drawing young people in under the umbrella and under the vision of Fellowship Church. So while we want Wednesday nights, which is when we have youth to grow, if we're not seeing growth reflected on Sundays, then we're not doing our
job. Right.
Because I'm not here to build my own platform.
Exactly.
I'm here to build the church. So,
what would you tell, Sam, young people?
I'd say, don't chase a platform. Chase Jesus within the confines of the local church. Submit yourself to the church. And when your pastor or your leader calls you out on something, realize that that is the greatest gift ever. Because your pastor calls you out, because he cares about you.